folks ain't got no broom over here, sis. We gotta spread out.
When the praises go up, the blessings come down. When the praises go up, the blessings come down. When the praises go up, the blessings come down. The Holy Ghost is all around. When the praises go up, the blessings come down. Praises go up, the blessings come down. When the praises go up, the blessings come down. When the praises go up, the blessings come down. The glory of the Lord is all around. When the praises go up, the blessings come down. Paul and Silas was thrown in jail. They did not worry who would go their bail. They began to pray, and praises went up. Then all of a sudden the walls began to shake, and there came a mighty earthquake. When the praises went up, the blessings came down. Praises go up, the blessings come down. When the praises go up, the blessings come down. When the praises go up, the blessings come down. For we are standing on holy ground. When the praises go up, the blessings come down. Praises go up, the blessings come down. When the praises go up, the blessings come down. When the praises go up, the blessings come down. The joy of the Lord is all around. When the praises go up, the blessings come down. Silas was thrown in jail. They did not worry who would go their bail. They began to pray, and praises went up. Then all of a sudden the walls began to shake, and there came a mighty earthquake. When the praises went up, the blessings came down. Paul and Silas was thrown in jail. They did not worry who would go their bail. They began to pray, and praises went up. Then all of a sudden the walls began to shake, and there came a mighty earthquake. When the praises went up, the blessings came down. When the praises go up, blessings come down. The Holy Ghost is all around. When the praises go up, the blessings come down. Paul and Silas was thrown in jail. They did not worry who would go their bail. They began to pray, and praises went up. Then all of a sudden the walls began to shake, and there came a mighty earthquake. When the praises went up, the blessings came down. When the praises go up, the blessings come down. When the praises go up, the blessings come down. blessings come down. Well, I never met a man, never met a man, never met a man like Jesus. I never met a man, never met a man, never met a man like Jesus. I never met a man, never met a man, never met a man like Jesus. He's my friend. Well, I never met a man, never met a man, never met a man like Jesus. I never met a man, never met a man, never met a man like Jesus. I never met a man, never met a man, never met a man like Jesus. He's my friend. Well, I never met a man, never met a man, never met a man like Jesus. I never met a man, never met a man, never met a man like Jesus. I never met a man, never met a man, never met a man like Jesus. He's my friend. Well, he healed my body, then he told me run home. He healed my body, then he told me run home. He healed my body, then he told me run home. He's my friend. Well, I never met a man, never met a man, never met a man like Jesus. I never met a man, never met a man, never met a man like Jesus. I never met a man, never met a man, never met a man like Jesus. He's my friend. Well, he saved my soul, put my name up on the roll. He saved my soul, put my name up on the roll. He saved my soul, put my name up on the roll. He's my friend. Shout of hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We wake up this morning. We come to worship God. Give him our very best today. I tell you, he deserves our very best. He gave us his very best. He sent Jesus Christ to die on the cross for you and I. He gave us the love that no other man on this earth could ever give us. He gave us a great love. His name is Jesus this morning. And he deserves a hand clap of praise. He deserves a hallelujah shout this morning. Because he's God. And he's not changed. He's still the same God today as he was last Sunday night. He's still the same God today as he was over 2,000 years ago. He's not changed. We change, but we need to give God praise in this house this morning. How many of you come expecting this morning a move of God, expecting him to just, I mean, you know, we need to bless God. We always say, God bless us, bless us, bless us. Let's just bless God today. How about that? Let's just bless him because he's been good to us. And you're the reason that he's the reason that we're still here today and breathing and not laid up somewhere and not able to attend church, you know. We come to the King of Kings house, the Lord of Lords, the Great I Am's house today. We're in a great place today, a great place to get blessed, a great place to get changed, a great place to get touched today, an awesome place to get healed today. God can still do those things, you know. He's still a miracle working God. I'm telling you, he's not changed. He's still the same.
same. I tell you, I feel him. He's in the house this morning, Brother Cletus, and I thank God for that. I thank God that whenever we show up, we bring him with us most of all, but he shows up right here for everybody else too this morning. He's a good God. Give him a hand clap of praise. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. 135.
Thank you, Jesus. Ooh, hallelujah. Each day that I live, it's been a long journey.
Well, it's been a long journey, but I have been blessed. Walking with Jesus, I have no regrets. He is so good to me, I must confess. The way has been long, but I'm blessed. It's been a long journey, but I have been blessed. Walking with Jesus, I have been blessed. Me, I must confess, the way has been long, but I'm blessed. Each day that I live, he gives more than I need. I can never describe his goodness to me. If you ask how I make it day after day, there's only one thing I can say. It's been a long journey, but I walking with Jesus, I have no regrets. He is so good to me, I must confess. The way has been long, but I'm blessed. All that I need, I find at his feet. When I'm hungry, he feeds me with manna so sweet. My soul is weary, he sends peace and rest. And all I I'm blessed. It's been a long journey, but I have been blessed. Walking with Jesus, I have no regrets. He is so good to me, I must confess. The way has been long, but I'm blessed. It's been a long journey, but I have been blessed. Walking with Jesus, I have no regrets. He is so good to me, and I must confess, the way has been long, but I'm blessed. It's been a long journey, but I have been blessed. Walking with Jesus, I have no regrets. He is so good to me, I must confess, the way has been long, but I'm blessed. My soul is weary, he sends peace and rest. And all I can say is I'm blessed. It's been a long journey, but I have been blessed. Walking with Jesus, I have no regrets. He is so good to me, and I must confess, the way has been long, but I'm blessed. The way has been long, but I'm blessed. The way has been long, but I'm blessed. Now I've had my share of sunshine and rain. Days filled with laughter and nights filled with pain. But with every mile as I travel this way, the journey gets sweeter each day. It's been a long journey, but I have been blessed. Walking with Jesus, I have no regrets. He is so good to me, I must confess. The way has been long, but I'm blessed. The way has been long, but I'm blessed. The way has been long, but I'm blessed.
Hallelujah. Let's give the Lord a big hand clap this morning. Praise the Lord. Amen. we take time to take our places in our Sunday school classes, amen. The children take their places. And teachers take their places. Let's give the Lord a hand clap, amen. Praise the Lord. God's a good God, amen. He knows what you're in need of, amen. Just thank the Lord for what He's doing, amen.
You've done this before I was here.
Just thank Him for what He's doing here today, amen. Praise the Lord, amen. Like I said, let's give our Sunday school teacher a hand clap, amen.
Praise the Lord.
You know, I'm a radical person. I love to praise and worship Jesus. He's been too good to me not to. I don't do it for show. I do it because He hears me when I get radical. He hears me when I'm loud, and He hears me when I cry out, and He's a good God. And how many of you know what today is? I hope y'all men hadn't forgot. Y'all in trouble.
Come on.
Today's the big day of Valentine's, and I don't really know the history of Valentine's, but I know it's a day that we represent as love, a day of loving each other, loving our mates, and showing our appreciation to each other. And, you know, I thank God that He sent Jesus to die and show us how much He loved us. You know, I think about, you know, Him going to the cross and how He had, before He ever made it to the cross, what He had to go through and the things that He had to endure, and He had to keep moving and keep marching because He was on a mission. He was on a journey. He was on a journey for you and I today. He had something that He had to accomplish because He was ordained to do so. You see, today we've got something that we need to accomplish for God, and it's more than about ourselves. It's more for God that we love each other and that we show the love of God to the world, a dying, lost world that has no love. You see, when I was in the world, Brother Cletus, I didn't find the kind of love that I was seeking and searching for until I met Jesus. When I met Jesus, He filled the void in my heart. He made me love. He showed me love. He gave me a love. He gave me a love that I could love my neighbor as I love myself. He gave me a love that I could love my enemy when they was my enemy. He gave me a love that I can't even understand why I love someone that would spit in my face, curse me, and talk about me, and stick a dagger in my side, and put a crown of thorns on my head, and give me vinegar to drink. You see, that's what He did. He did those things. He went to the cross for you and I. He went up there because He loved us. And you know, God wants us to love like He loved, like He wants us to love like Christ loved the church. He wants us to love our spouses as Christ loved the church. You see, today I see a great falling away of marriages. I see things that the enemy's coming in, and I seen one just recently, broke my heart. I prayed. I didn't know what to do. I could only give encouragement, give the word. But you see, something will happen when you get out of the will of God. When you are in the will of God and something comes along to tear you out and bring you out of the will of God, you can expect that the hedge has been down and been broken. You've got to keep the hedge up in your life because there is a devil himself coming after you. He's on your trail, and if he ain't on your trail, you better watch out. Something's wrong. But I tell you, the devil don't like a marriage. He don't like love, and he don't like a family to be together. He comes to steal and to kill and destroy. We've got to recognize that we are not fighting against ourselves, but we are fighting against a spirit of principalities, a spirit of wickedness in high places. We've got to recognize that the devil don't like us, and he don't like us to walk in love and unity with a brother. He don't like us to walk in love and unity with the neighbor. He would rather have us in division and tearing us apart from limb to limb and causing so much confusion in our homes, in our churches, in your place of work, wherever you may be. I guarantee you, if you're there long enough, you're going to fight the enemy because he's after us, church. But we've got power to tread over the enemy. If we recognize what we're fighting today, if we recognize that we're not fighting our flesh, we're fighting a spirit called the devil. I didn't really know where to go this morning, and to be honest, God really didn't give me nothing till this morning. This is all He really gave me, and I just don't know where it's going. But all I want to do is be obedient with the Lord and do the best I can with what He's given me.
Yes.
But this is a question today. What is love? When you think about love, what do you think about? Do you think about love being as money? Is money love? The Bible says money is the root of what? All evil. Do you think material things is love? Magic is love? A lot of times we find a lot of folks falling in love today, but they're really not in love. They just fell in lust. You see, it's very wise to pray, you know, and seek God for your direction in marriage. It's very important to know who your other, as Derek said, he's my rib. I told him the other night, I'm your rib. He said, no, I'm your rib. I said, oh, well, whatever. Anyway, but we need to find our match, you see. And the only way we're going to find our match is to pray, seek God, and ask Him to find who he has prepared for you and I.
Come on.
You see, a lot of times we'll get in God's way. You see, I believe within all my heart. I've been married before, and I know most of y'all know that. I believe with all my heart, if I'd listened to Carolyn Sue Tucker, I wouldn't have got married, because she come to me and she said, I don't believe this is him. I don't believe it. She said, but I'm going to say this. If you'll get in church, she said, if you'll get in church and you put God at the beginning of your marriage, everybody says in the middle, but really you got to put Him at the beginning of your marriage. And then she said, if you'll put God at the first of your marriage, she said, you'll make it. I tell you what, I tried everything in that marriage but God. I tried moving. I tried changing. I tried doing everything I possibly could to make my marriage work, but it would not work, and the last resort was God. I never tried God, because of course we all know that we all got a past and we all got things and choices that we make every day. But I tell you what, when I got ahead of God and got married to someone I don't think God wanted me to be married to. And you say, do what? Yes, that's right. The Bible says to pray about all things, seek Him about all things. You see, if I'd have been in church and not backslidden in church, I'd been praying for my helpmate. I've been praying, and God would have sent probably Derek, because I believe God sent me Derek. And you know, I could have saved myself of a lot of hardship and troubles because I would have been listening to God and not my flesh.
Amen, sis. Come on.
What is love? It's maintaining patience when you're going through the storms, sorrows, and situations of life. Let's go to 1 Corinthians right quick. I'm going to read this out of the Bible. You know, I got it wrote down.
Come on, sis.
Help me, Jesus. See, I got a new Bible, so it's kind of hard for me to find my 1 Corinthians. God is love. God does not limit. He has unlimited love. Ain't you so glad that He loves you? He loved you when you was out in the dark, sinful world, living your own life. He still loved you. He loves you today as well as He loved you then. He loved you at your worst. I've said that before lately.
Come on.
He loves you at your very worst as well as He loves you at your very best.
Mm-hmm.
Because God is a God of love. And if we don't love each other, then we don't have God. The Bible says so. Let's see if I can find this right quick. 1 Corinthians 13, verse 4. Let's just go up to 3. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, and have not charity, it profiteth me nothing. Charity suffereth long and is kind. Charity envieth not. Charity vaineth not. Itself is not puffed up. Does not behave itself unseemly. Seeketh not her own. Is not easily provoked. And thinketh no evil.
Mm-hmm.
You see, love does not seek its own. It's See, if Jesus had sought his own, Jesus wouldn't have walked, I believe, if he wanted to seek his own, the earth to do. He would not have done what he did for you and I. He would have not have walked to Mount Calvary and took up the cross for you and I if he sought his own. Today we need to realize that we need to take up our cross and we need to not seek after ourselves. We need to seek after what God's will would be in our life. We need to seek after the love that God would have us to have for those that try to destroy us, that try to come against us, that try to persecute us. You see, it's kind of it shows something to the world when somebody comes up and they smack you and you look at them and say, "I'm going to pray for you," and walk away. You see, that shows the world something that they don't got, because see, the world is taught, "You hit me, I hit you back." You see, but Jesus teaches us not to do that. Jesus teaches us to love those that hit us. He teaches us to love those that talk about us. He teaches us to love those that come against us. You see, we are to be like Christ, and that's how. And love is Christ, right? Mm-hmm. Love is Christ. See, there's two kinds of love in this world. There's a love that you get naturally, and then there's an agape love that God gives you when you get born again and saved. The agape love, the kind of love that you don't know where the love come from, when you know what's been going on behind your back, when you know what someone's been doing, when you know you love them anyway, and you pray for them anyway, as Jesus said on the cross, "Father, forgive them," after they've done all these things to Christ on the cross, or before the cross, he looked down and said, "Father, forgive them." He did not one time try to push them. He did not one time ridicule them. He did not one time curse them. He did not one time smack them. He did not one time even open his mouth to try to destroy them. He showed the love that he wanted us to see. You see, when I look at the cross, I look at Jesus, I see love. You should see love, because he showed us love and he gave us love. He loves us today. There's nothing that Jesus wouldn't do for you and I.
Right,
and he proved it.
Mm-hmm.
He proved it. He proved it when he walked up Golgotha's hill carrying a cross that he couldn't even hardly carry. But even though he had to carry it, he had a little help to carry the cross. You know, today we got help to carry our cross. His name is Jesus. He wants us to cry out to him and let him help us carry our cross. Let him change us. Let him mold us. Let him touch our heart. Let him get inside of our heart and change and mold and make it into Christ's likeness, that we may glorify him and be in his perfect will. I tell you, God wants us to have the love like we've never had before. And I don't know why God gave me love. I thought, "Lord, now today's Valentine's Day and you want me to teach on love. What a great coincidence." I don't believe in coincidence. I believe somebody here today needs to hear this. I believe today maybe you ain't loving somebody the way you need to love them. But I tell you what, the way around everything that may be going on is to show them love. Show them love with all that you got in you, no matter what. If they come to you and they need to be fed, feed them. I don't care if they are your enemy. I don't care if they have been the ones down the road talking about you for over a year. I tell you, feed them anyway. You can't go wrong, because you see, God's got a plan, and God will work his plan out if we'll be obedient and do it God's way. You see, we've got to love our brother as we love ourselves. Maintaining a positive attitude with a forgiving spirit. Love goes right along with forgiveness. If you don't have love in your heart, you won't be able to forgive. Especially when you've been hit hard. When you've been hit hard and it hurts and it's deep down inside you, and you just want to hold on to that thing that someone did to you, or someone said about you, or maybe they even stole from you, or whatever the situation may be, it's love that's going to pull you out of that situation. It's love that's going to help you to forgive them and let go. Because you see, God would have us to, he said you have to forgive how many times?
7 times 70.
Ooh, it's a lot of forgiving in a day, ain't it? That tells us that we have no choice but to forgive. Now, we can choose to not forgive and hang on to unforgiveness. There's different spirits that we have to fight. Everybody fights, to me, I believe everybody fights a different thing in their life, and maybe forgiveness ain't one that you fight. But I tell you, if the devil knows it about you, he knows exactly who you are, and he knows if you have a hard time forgiving. He knows it, and if he knows it, guess what? Guess what's coming your way? There's going to come something your way that the devil's going to try to get you to be have an unforgiving spirit about, just so he can take you down. I tell you, we got to get aware of who we're fighting. It's called the devil himself. He's like a roaring lion going to seeking whom he may devour. And I'm telling you, we've got to forgive. Don't hang on to that thing right away, even though you feel it. Just right away tell the devil, I'm forgiving him no matter what. I'm forgiving him, because devil, I'm going forward. I'm not going backwards. I'm moving on. So you take whatever you got that you're trying to throw my way. Guess what, devil? It ain't working this time. Oh, my brother, I love you. I forgive you for trespassing against me, but I'm moving on, and you can move on with me. But I tell you what, the devil don't want us to move on. He wants us to go backwards or to stay right there in the mud puddle and get on a little bit dirtier. See that? He's got tricks up his sleeve, because he sniffs you. He knows when you're a child of God, and he's going to send things your way. Just to just try to destroy you, to stop you, to keep you from doing God's will, from obeying the Lord, from growing in God, because unforgiveness will stop your growth. It will. And what will happen is, when you get an unforgiving spirit, we're going to touch this a little bit and move on. But when you get an unforgiving spirit, guess what? You're opening up more door for more spirit to come in. And the next thing you know, you're going to have a whirlwind, and you're going to wonder what in the world happened. You see, we got to know that we've got to forgive. Because why? Jesus said we had to forgive. 7 times 70. It's a fact. We have to forgive. We can't hold on to those things. So many times I've had things that come into my life, and I'm telling you, the devil one time had me. I didn't want to forgive somebody, and I said, and I didn't even really realize I had it in my heart until Derek looked at me and said, Sandra, you shouldn't be talking like that. So you can hear it when it comes out. You can't hide what's in your heart. You see, because what's in your heart eventually going to come out, and you're going to hear it, and you're going to see it. It's going to act up and act out, and you've got to realize that you've got a spirit of unforgiveness. And when he smacked me, not literally smacked me, but in the spirit realm, smacked me and let me know that I shouldn't be talking like that. Not that I cursed or said anything, but it's just what come out of my heart and what come out of my mouth. Look at them, who they think they are. And I tell you, when he did that, it was just like God saying, psh, you got to let that go. You got to forgive, and you got to move on. And you know what? I prayed. Let me tell you, it ain't going to be easy to let it go. You got to pray. You got to get along with God. You got to ask God to help you to let go of it and help you to move past it and to forgive them. And I'm telling you, when you truly forgive them, guess what's next? Guess what's next? When you finally say, okay, God, I forgive them. Help me, God, to forgive them. Guess what's going to happen? You're going to be put through a test. Next thing you know, they're going to be calling your telephone, or they're going to be showing up your house, or you're going to run into them at Walmart, and you're going to really know then if you forgave them. Because I'm going to tell you, that's how God works. He worked it like that with me. He let me know that he wanted to see if I truly forgave him. And I thank God that I had, and I was able to move into God's will and do what God would have me to do that day. And you know, God's got a plan, but we can mess up the whole plan if we don't let go and let God be God. If we don't let go of this unforgiveness and let God clean us up and move in our hearts and move these things out, this bad that was preached a couple of weeks ago, and let God put us back on the potter's wheel and make us and mold us into his image, his likeness, because it pleases God for us to love each other. What is love? It's maintaining a positive attitude with a forgiving spirit toward others despite the faults, failures, and unintentional mistakes that come along. In 13 and 7 it says, beareth all things, believeth all things, hopeth all things, endureth all things. That's love. Love does those things. When we love someone, we don't just get up and run off and leave them. We hang in there with them. You see, that's what's wrong with the church today. You get a problem in the church and they're up ready to root off and leave the whole church, and God not even tell them to leave. You see, we're a family, you see here. We're a family. We're going to have trials. We're going to be tempted by the enemy. We're going to have struggles. But a family sticks together. Love sticks together. Love doesn't leave because things get hard. Love doesn't leave because you don't know that you can stand here any longer. Love sticks together, Derek. We got to stick together because that's what love does. Love endures all things. We've got to endure the hardships. We've got to endure. You know, when it's all good and glory, we want to be, oh, hallelujah, praise God. But then when it gets bad, we want to, as the old saying goes, tuck tail and run. You know, but we can't be like that. God wants us to come together, stick together, work through it together. I tell you, this church has been going now for about how long, 10 years? I guess, and then it's had some knockdowns, drag outs. We got battle scars. We've got people that's left. We've got people that's come back. We've got people that we ain't never seen before come back. But I tell you what, we're still standing. We're standing because why? God's called us. He's anointed us, and he's got a timing, and God's up to something. And I tell you, it hadn't been easy, Brother John. It hadn't been easy to stand when you only got four in the church there with you. It hadn't been easy to stand when you feel like the all hell is coming against you. It hasn't been easy, but let me tell you, it wasn't easy for Jesus either. It wasn't easy for Jesus. It took him getting in the Garden of Gethsemane and praying. Even those that he told, pray, Peter. Pray, disciples. Pray with me. But they fell asleep, Derek. They fell asleep on Jesus. See, it's going to sometimes be a time that it ain't going to be nobody but you and Jesus. You see, you can't count on everybody. You got to count on Jesus. He's the one that makes the way. He's the one that made a way for Jesus. And I tell you, he's the one that Jesus got along with his Father, and that's how he was able to overcome the tempter. Even when he was in the wilderness, the enemy come to tempt him. But you see, he was a praying Jesus. He knew what he had to do to make it. And I look back and I think, God, I don't know that I could have done all that. I don't really know that I could have took the cross like Jesus did. But I know this. The only way I know Jesus took that cross was because God the Father, because he had a relationship with God the Father. And the only way that, church, that we're going to make it is to have that relationship with God the Father. Spend the time alone with God the Father and let God's will unfold in our life that he'll mold and do. How many of you know, the closer, the more time you spend in God's presence, the more time you spend with God, the more you begin to look like Jesus. And the more you begin to look like Jesus, the more you begin to love like Jesus. The more you begin to walk like Jesus. I'm not saying we're Jesus because he was a perfect. Was perfect. We're not perfect. But I'm saying this, we're to strive to be perfect. And the more that you get, you spend that time with the Lord, the more that you're going to be able to overcome the old tempter, the devil, who's seeking to devour and destroy. The more we can overcome him is by spending the time with the Lord Jesus Christ. 1 John 15 and 13, right quick. Does anybody have anything to say? I know this is Sunday school, but I get a little excited. I can't help it.
Bless you, Lord.
You know, Jesus loves every one of us today. What a wonderful place to be in.
Yep. Bless you, Lord.
Anybody got there yet? I'm trying to get there still. Keep turning the pages. Pages are new and they're sticking together. John chapter 15, verse 13. It says, greater love has no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friend. No greater love.
Amen.
Than Jesus had for us. When he laid down his life for you and I. He's a God of an unlimited love. But we can't afford to lose the love of God. We can't afford to not love like God. I'm not here to beat you up. We all fail and make mistakes. Believe me, I've got upset on the telephone before with a receptionist and had to call back and say, look, I'm so sorry. I was going through something in my life one time and I thought I was literally dying. No joke. And I called and trying to get in the doctor's office and they said, well, you owe $15 or $10. It was a very little bit of money. And she was really rude and ugly to me. And I'm thinking, lady, I feel like I'm about to die here. And you know, I was really ugly to her because I was feeling, like I was at my weakest point or something. And you know, God dealt with my heart. And I had to call that lady up and I had to tell her, look, ma'am, I'm sorry. I said, you know, please forgive me for being ugly to you because I shouldn't have acted that way. I said, but, you know, I just want you to forgive me. And, you know, there's times that we're going to have to be the lesser. Do you know that God loves it when we humble ourselves? You see, He wants us to humble ourselves. And because when we humble ourselves, it shows the love of God in our life. Sometimes we have to take the lesser of a road, but really it's the greater of the road. Because the greater of the road is going to get us to heaven one day. The lesser of the road won't. It's a narrow path that we're having to go down. And we've got to be wise as we're walking that path. But you know, God loved the children of Israel. He loved them so much that He sent Moses over there to tell Pharaoh, let my children go. Even though the children of Israel wasn't all seeking God. They weren't all doing God's will. There was some over there that was liars. There was some over there that was sinning. There was sinning, but He still loved them. He still had a great love for the children of Israel. And he made a way, you know, to bring them out of that captivity they was in, that bondage. And He made a way for them. But that's because He loved the children of Israel. And that's why He departed the Red Sea for them so they could escape. You know, the Lord said He would put no more upon us than we could bear. And He would make an escape for us. And you know, even at our worst, He still loves us. If you don't get nothing today out of this, just know that God loves you. He loves you. Jesus loves you. And no matter if you're at your worst, He still loves you. But you see, we need to recognize that you know, we need to know that God can lift things out of our life. He can lift, as He lifted the things out of the children of Israel's life, He can lift things out of our life. And He's a good God, and He careth for you and I. And you know, I thank God that He laid down His life for me. I thank God for that. Because if you knew where I come from and where I used to be and the things I used to do, you see, when God moves in, there's a change. There's going to be a change in your life. There's going to be a change in your heart. And there's going to be a change that you couldn't have done without God. I tell you, God changed Sister Sandra. And have I failed? Yes. Have I faltered? Yes. Have I sinned? Yes. But I tell you what, I recognize it. I get up. I pray. I ask God to forgive me and move on and seek God. Because you see, I'm not perfect either. But I don't want to use I'm not perfect as an excuse to sin. We can't use, well, I'm not perfect. Well, no, we're not perfect. But we're to strive to be perfect. We're to strive to be like Christ. And we're to do the best we can at it. But it's going to take God to help us to be like Christ. It's going to take God's Spirit to lead us and guide us and to quench us when we do wrong. You see, I can't do wrong because if I do wrong, I've got the Holy Ghost inside that says, repent. Make it right. Do the right thing. Yeah. How many of you know that sometimes doing the right thing, when you feel like it ain't the right thing, you don't want to do the right thing? And there's a scripture that backs that up. Your flesh, well, you know what, Brother Johnny, about your flesh? Your spirit's willing, but your flesh is weak. You know, I've experienced that very thing, because wanting to do the right thing sometimes is hard to do the right thing, but we have to do the right thing. We have to do whatever God, the right thing is whatever the Word of God says. And this morning I want you to know that Jesus loves you, and I hope you got something out of this. And, you know, God is love, and He's got an unlimited love for you. He's got so much in store for each and every one of us. And, you know, we just need to reach out and grab what God's got for us and strive to be like Christ and just keep loving Jesus.
Amen.
And Derek's over here looking at me strange, and I don't know why, but anyway. You know, I want to say I love my husband, and yesterday, my Valentine's kind of started yesterday, and I didn't expect it, really. I really always say, you don't have to get me nothing, you know, whatever. But I think he knows if he don't, he's in trouble. So, but anyway, I got up, and he had took my car and washed it. Poor car, it needed it bad. He worked out so hard, his thumb was hurting when he got home. He said, that car was nasty. I said, I've been meaning to get it cleaned. I just, every time I think about it, I get home and don't get it clean. But anyway, and then I had my oil changed, and then he took me out to dinner, and then I come in this morning, I got flowers and a card and candy. So I think he did a good job, but, you know, I love my husband, and thank God for him, because, you know, our mate, if you ever noticed in a marriage, when one's down, the other one's pulling the other one up, it's either one way or the other. You know, God gives us a mate for a reason, because we're there to help each other, and you know, I thank God for sending Derek to me, even though sometimes I oh God, why? But you know, we all have those moments. I'm just being real. I'm being real with you. I mean, I'm Sandra, and believe me, you got to know my background and where I came from. And you would be saying, God is good, and God does miracles for me to be married for 14 years, I'm telling you. Because in my background, nobody stayed married. And every woman in it was like, I don't need a man. I can do it without a man, you know. We can do it without a man, but we can't do it without Jesus. He's the most important man we could ever have. Like the song says, I never met a man like Jesus. But if Derek's a lot like Jesus, he's not Jesus, but you know, he's got the love. And if he didn't have the love that he had when I met him, you know, I don't think I'd still be married, because I'm telling you, God's done a lot in me, and he's still changing me and molding and making me. But if Derek had the love of God, that's what drawed me to Derek, was that love of God. And I could feel it, I could see it. And, you know, the love of God, when you got the love of God in you, you're going to begin to draw people to you.
Mm-hmm.
Get ready. You know, I'm not saying nobody don't have the love of God. Don't get me wrong. I rebuke the devil right now in the name of Jesus. But, you know, the love of God will do a whole lot more than what our love can do. We got to have that agape, that love, that great love. But anyway, give the Lord a hand clap this morning. He's worthy to be praised.